Thank you very much for having the opportunity to report about our project, laying the foundations for the Australian Critical Zone Observatories. And although I'm the one who is reporting about that, I want to acknowledge my many co-authors in that project who contributed into the thinking and the results of this little presentation and the project overall. Now, we want to report about the critical zone, which is a zone that sustains terrestrial life, or a different definition would be the zone that starts from the top of the tree canopy all the way down to the bedrock. And it's about this vertical integration between the atmosphere, the biosphere, the hydrosphere, and the lithosphere. And last year, we were successful in securing an ARC LEAF grant called Founding an Australian Critical Zone Observatory Network, where basically five sites and groups collaborated together to initiate the critical zone community here in Australia, a very successful program over the past 15 years across the globe, a little bit underrepresented still in the Southern Hemisphere, and we hope to change that in the near future. Now, with this ARC LEAF grant, there came a bunch of equipment which needs to be deployed in the field. We aim to have this equipment located at nearby TERN places. So TERN stands for the Terrestrial Ecosystem Research Network, and they target a lot about the gas and energy fluxes around these flux towers, but also target a lot about the biological diversity on these places, whereas our components target more the hydrologic components and the gas and water fluxes with the deeper subsurface via classical boreholes down to the aquifer, but also some permanent electric resistivity monitoring arrays where we hope to have time-lapse infiltration fronts displayed over the time. And it also includes a so-called Waddell zone monitoring system which comes from Israel, where basically we drill in a certain angle and hope to get gas and solute sampling from undisturbed soil profiles from above. Now, the big question around this new equipment is always where to place the new infrastructure to cover the complexity and variability of the critical zone, as we want to make the most use out of this. And here kicks the AuScope Opportunity Fund in, as we are able via that fund to apply shallow geophysical techniques such as electric resistivity tomography and also seismic refraction to provide as much subsurface information as possible. And that includes, for example, simple targets like depths to bedrock, water table depths, sedimentologic layering within the installation of our equipment, and characteristics of the weathering profile prior to installing this equipment. And as said, this will be done across all five core sites. Now, these sites are very different, and I'm giving a very quick initial results from the site at Western Australia here, the UWA farm in Pingelly. And as you maybe already can see, we have these hills within this agricultural agriculturally used area, which are deeply weathered lateritic hills with a dury crust, an iron-enriched crust, some remnant vegetation next to our agriculturally used area. But on the other side, where we assume this is a very, very deeply weathered profile, on the other side we have these granitic outcrops just 100, 150 meters besides, where the critical zone would be close to zero. So basically that's already the bedrock. But here we have some deep weathering pockets and that's what we are targeting. The profile itself is a very classic lateritic regolith profile, as it is very often well described for many zones in Australia, with a iron enriched dury crust, deeply weathered, depleted, mottled and pallid zones with a lot of mainly kaolinite and partly gypsite as the clay minerals, then going deeper into the saprolite and the weather bedrock down to the weathering front. And using shallow geophysics allows us to get this 2D, pseudo 3D overview of the variability of these sections, and that's why we basically deployed the geophysical instruments to get different areas covered and to find the best location for our instrumentation. Now, the good thing in this location is that we can access the various weathering zones rather easily as we walk along these hills, and by little drill cores we can confirm the geophysics along these lines. For example, here a geophysical electric resistivity line that displays the so-called critical zone architecture, with the red colors here in the higher resistivity values displaying the weathered bedrock down to the more solid bedrock cores, and our dury crust on the very top with the very high resistivity values. But then you can see these blue colors, they represent the very low electric resistivities between roughly 7 and 20 ohm meters. That not only is an indication for clay, for moist clays, but in this case also for salinity issues. We do have some salinity affected areas, and that's always a big challenge for electromagnetic or electrical geophysical methods, as this blurs a lot of the sedimentologic properties that you want to cover. Now, the high variability over short distances is also visible at this next slide here, where on the bottom you see that we pick up the weathered bedrock at about 25 meter depths via the sharp gradients to higher resistivity values, overlain by the weathered clay, which is mostly very moist and slightly saline, represented by the very low resistivity values. We do have equally low resistivity values here in the upper line, but what we are missing are the clear gradient towards the bedrock. We would assume it is at that same depth, however we can't see it. At the moment we don't know whether this is due to the fact that it's simply deeper and we didn't pick it up, or whether the salinity blurs the bedrock here if it intrudes basically into the weathered cracks and fractured bedrock, and therefore providing lower resistivity values. This is when we use seismic refraction to confirm the depths to bedrock, where we basically use acoustic waves which are not sensitive to the salinity to confirm or reject the depths to bedrock in this case. I was also asked to report about the challenges of this project, and the biggest obviously for us were the travel restrictions, especially being here in WA. It seemed to be near impossible to get out of the state and coming back without the necessary consequences. So the solution that the team came up with was that we would now send the equipment to individual institutions. We produced and provide now a bunch of induction videos how to apply the equipment in the field, and the various participants would then send back the raw data to UWA where the data is post-processed. Now, the risks involved in such an approach obviously are the difficulties associated with data acquisition in the field. As you know, when you apply geophysics, things can go wrong during the fieldwork, and that needs a lot of attention, sometimes remotely, sometimes via telephone calls. The benefit, obviously, of this approach is that more people are trained on these instruments, which is always an encouraging fact. And with that, we are also able to build up a little instrument pool that can be sent around and can be used in the future. But if you are interested in shallow geophysics, or if you are a trained geophysicist and you're interested in participating in this project, please don't be shy and contact me or any of the CIs of the other projects and project sites. You're most welcome to collaborate and come on board so that we can increase and get the most out of this project. With that, I want to conclude. Thank you very much for listening. Thanks also again to my co-authors, and I really hope that critical zone science will be a big topic also in the geoscience community, not only in the bioscience community, that this is an holistic approach, how we look at the zone that sustains terrestrial life. Thank you very much.